My name is Dr. Edgar Tay from the Asian Heart and Vascular Center. I'm an interventional cardiologist with an interest in structural heart disease as well as pulmonary hypertension. Atrial fibrillation is a medical term for an irregular kind of heartbeat. This occurs because patients may have certain reasons like hypertension, increasing age, or if they have previous valve disease. These are conditions that can result in the patient having an irregular kind of heartbeat. Many people with atrial fibrillation do not have valvular heart disease. When atrial fibrillation occurs, the left atrium has an erratic or chaotic blood flow. And when that happens, clots tend to form. And when these clots form, they typically form in a structure known as the left atrial appendage. The danger then occurs when these clots start to migrate. And if they migrate and travel along with blood to the brain, they can cause things like stroke. So in order to reduce this risk of atrial fibrillation causing strokes, patients are started on certain medications. We call these medications blood thinners. In the past, we have an old drug called warfarin, and this has been utilized for the past 60 years. It's effective, but can actually come with some disadvantages. For example, they have to have repeated blood tests to make sure that this blood thinner is safe for them. There are also newer agents. We call these novel anticoagulants, or in short, we call them NOACs. These are drugs that are also blood thinners, but a little bit more convenient than the older warfarin. Blood thinners or anticoagulants are very useful in preventing clot formation within the heart, and therefore they're very effective in reducing the risk of strokes in patients with atrial fibrillation. But because they are so effective, they also predisposes patients to have complications like bleeding. Oftentimes this bleeding may be very mild, so it could be like a patient having an injury or cut that requires them to press on the wound for a longer period of time, or some bruising that occasionally can occur. But in certain situations, bleeding can become more serious. For example, if bleeding occurs in the gut or in the stomach, this can cause a significant loss of blood. Or even more seriously, some patients may even have bleeding in the brain and cause a stroke. So these are actually some of the side effects of anticoagulation. When we consider the alternatives of treatment for patients with atrial fibrillation to reduce the risk of stroke, we always need to balance the risk of giving blood thinners to prevent stroke and yet balancing the risk of bleeding when we give these blood thinners. So your doctors will usually assess and balance this risk for you, because there is a few things we need to consider, including things like your risk of previous bleeding, your risk, things like age, and the type of illnesses that some patients may have. So it's really a balance of this risk and benefit. There will be some patients, no matter how we balance this risk, will be at increased risk of bleeding. And in those cases, such medications may not be suitable for them. In which case, we have an alternative now called a left atrial appendage closure. This is really a technique where we try to actually implant a device into a certain section of the heart called the left atrial appendage, and this actually reduces the risk of stroke. In patients with non-valvular atrial fibrillation, 90% of these clots are formed within the left atrial appendage. So what this device, appendage occluder, does is that we actually stopper the entry point of this pouch, and therefore we don't allow blood to actually travel within this pouch to form clots. And at the same time, when the body heals over this stopper, it actually forms a complete seal of the orifice or the door to this pouch. And therefore, over a certain period of time, the patient will no longer be able to form clots in this appendage, and therefore the stroke risk becomes reduced. The left atrial appendage closure procedure is a minimally invasive procedure done under general anesthesia. We generally use GA or general anesthesia because it is more comfortable for the patient. And usually the whole procedure lasts for about 1 hour. We start by putting a small incision in the patient's thigh, and then through this we insert a very small and fine tube that travels from the thigh all the way to the heart, to the vicinity of the atrial appendage. From there, we will then put a stopper, which is the device, into the atrial appendage orifice, or the opening of the atrial appendage, and stopper this section of the heart. Once we have completed this, all the other devices will be removed from the patient's body, and then we will apply some gentle pressure on the puncture site. And afterwards, the patient will then rest in the hospital for about one day, so overnight, and then should be able to go back the next day if there's no bleeding or further bruising of the legs. Once you return home, we would advise you taking things easy for the first few days because you want a wound to heal completely. Usually the doctors would then advise you to take some new blood thinners for a short period of time, usually in the first 45 days. When we talk about more aggressive or strenuous type activities, we will advise you to talk to us first to see how the wound is and how your recovery is. And then we will advise you accordingly about what activities can then be kind of increased over time. With regards to the further long-term care, after about 45 days, we expect there to be quite a lot of healing within the heart itself. So at that point in time, we usually will schedule an appointment for you to come back to have an ultrasound scan done. This is called a transesophageal echocardiogram. Essentially, we put a ultrasound probe down the food tube and we can see the device and how it interacts with the heart very clearly. Once that confirms that the device is very stable and is healed, we can then reduce the amount of blood thinners that you have. After that, things are generally back to normal. You can engage in most of your usual activities. And at about the 1 year time point, we'll probably bring you back again to evaluate the overall situation, assess how you are, and perhaps do another ultrasound scan just to make sure that the heart is healing well with this device. And then I think you should be back to your usual activities.